As Luke said, my name is Patria Burchard, and I think maybe that's why you're here, not because I'm Patria Burchard, but because I played Ryoko. So I'd love to answer any questions I can about Ryoko and Tenshi Muyo. Go easy on me, it's been a while. I do remember a few good things about it. In fact, everything I remember about it is good. It was a really wonderful experience, and as I was telling Gemma a little earlier, she met, do you mind if I say?
Yeah.
She met her husband in a Tenshi chat room 17 years ago. And the 17 years for me was significant because 17 years ago, I had no idea there was such a thing as a Tenshi chat room. I didn't know that people were paying attention. I didn't know that there was an audience out there for Tenshi Muyo. I did get the occasional note from a fan, and that was great, but it's only been the recent, maybe 10 years, especially the most recent 5 years, that people have really been contacting me, getting in touch, wanting me to come to cons and stuff, and I think that's about Tenshi Muyo, and that maybe about the 20th anniversary and stuff like that, but it's been great because everybody has been so kind to me, and it's wonderful to be invited all the way across the pond to England. I'm thrilled to be here, and couldn't be happier. So thank you for coming tonight. And I'll just start by answering one question that a lot of people ask me, which is, what have I been doing for the last 25 years? Have I been doing anything? And I have. I only did the one anime, which was Tenshi Muyo. Since then, I have been active in voiceover, just not in anime, and not internationally. So if you are in Southern California, you will hear my radio commercials. I'm the glamorous voice of one of the local grocery store chains, which has been a great job for 15 years or so. And I also have, not recently, but up until about 5 or 6 years ago, I did some on-camera acting, which was the main reason I moved to California in the first place, was to be an on-camera actor, working TV and film. But voiceover became the thing that I was most successful at, and now it turns out to be the thing that's the most gratifying as well. And I really enjoy the work. So, thank you. Who has a question? Anybody? Let's start with
that. If there was one role that you could choose from, like say a movie or like a TV drama or even like an animated movie you could used to work on, who would it be and what reason? Like if you could choose any in the world.
Well, since this is fantasy, it would be Juliet. The reason being that I have never been right for the part. Even when I was Juliet's age, I was always more of the tough girl type. And I loved Franco Zeffirelli's picture from 1968. And his movie is the thing that inspired me to study Shakespeare and to become an actor. And so Olivia Hussey got the part, and she was really right for it. But we were right about the same age at the same time. Yeah. So I was like, my God, somebody my age, she was, I think, 13, maybe 14. I was 13, and I was so inspired by the language, the beauty, the costumes, all of it. So yeah, it would be Juliet. Thank you for asking. Anybody else? Yes, Jack.
Probably have lots of questions, but just something, as you touched on it a second ago, that Tenshi Muyo was like a great experience. What's like your fondest memory from it?
My fondest memory from it. This might end up being it. Right here, right now. My fondest memory, I guess, might be the fact that I became good friends with Matt Miller. Matt and I were already friends. That's kind of how I got the job. We knew each other in Chicago and we were at theater actors in Chicago. And I don't know when he moved to Los Angeles, but I was living there, and he moved there with his wife at the time, Jessica, and she was producing this anime. And she asked me to audition, to send in a tape. And at that time, yes, it was a tape. I sent in a tape, they gave me a script, I read Ryoko, and I got the part, and that's the old, who you know really helps. So getting to work with Matt on this project, because we were always good buddies and we worked together very well, even though often we didn't get to work together in the studio. I don't know if I should just go on with that story or not, but we did the first couple of episodes before we had a union contract. This might be somebody's question, why did we use pseudonyms? The first couple of episodes, we didn't have a union contract yet. So the producers, Pioneer, promised us a union contract, but we couldn't use our real names for the first couple of episodes. Even though they were paying us union wage, without the contract, we were really actually kind of doing scab work. So, and we did these first two episodes together in a fabulous studio, but they had to separate us because when you're acting with somebody, as you probably know, it's very hard to just wait until they're finished before you react. So you're with each other, you're working together, you're reacting to each other, and that's what Matt and I were doing when we were acting together, and they would have to say, no, you can't talk until he's finished talking. But I was over there going, oh, yeah, just reacting to him. So we ended up having to work separately in the studio. So I never actually got to work with any of the other actors. It was only Matt. But the rest of the time you'd go into the studio, hopefully somebody would have been in there and already done their lines, like KT Boat. I had some great scenes with her, but she was never in the booth with me. I would hear her voice in my headphones and I could react to her and act with her, but she wasn't actually there. And that's how we did most of the scenes. Did I answer your question? I just went off on some of the tangents. Yeah. Anybody else have a question? Yes?
If you didn't voice act Ryoko, who would you have chosen to voice?
If I could choose?
Yeah.
Ooh, for voice acting. Marge Simpson. I think I probably wouldn't do as good a job as what's Julie's last name?
Kavner,
yes. I've got a story about that show, too. I never auditioned for it. No, I have nothing to do with the show, actually. But when I worked in Chicago as an actor, I was in the touring company of the Second City, which is a famous comedy company. And we toured colleges and stuff. And one of the people I toured with was Dan Castellaneta, who plays Homer. And so when I moved to Los Angeles, Dan was working on the Tracy Ullman show. And they had this cast of funny people playing all different characters on Tracy's show. And they did these funny cartoons. And the funny cartoons were about this family, the Simpsons. So Julie Kavner, Yardley Smith, Dan Castellaneta, and the woman who plays Bart, I can't remember her name either, but she's fabulous. They were already working on the Tracy Ullman show a couple of years before The Simpsons, doing these little interstitial cartoons. So that's my Simpsons show, Simpsons story. But Dan, I worked with Dan. Haven't seen him in a while, though. He's a busy guy. You had a question too, sir?
Sorry, it was a follow-up about what you were saying about doing when you're recording.
Mm-hmm.
It always seemed to me that doing them solo, each person one at a time, it seems like it's either a very unhelpful way of doing it. You can't act off other people. You can't. Is it difficult to get a rapport with someone that's not really there?
Well, yes and no. Yes, because it's better if they're there. For me, but it's just impossible for the engineer, the sound engineer, because The sound from his microphone would bleed onto my microphone. They can't separate the tracks. So I might have a really good take and his isn't that good, or vice versa. So they would want separate tracks for everybody so they can mix us. But I would also say that that's my job. And so I need to be able to act with somebody who's not there. And the actor who works, for example, in front of a green screen, or wearing one of those suits with all the little nodules on it, they're having to imagine so much and perform with things that aren't there, that that becomes part of the actor's job. So we just have to be good at it. We have to believe in it so strongly that you believe in it. That's the job.
For doing voiceover work for commercials, that's obviously going to be a lot more different than anything where you have a character where you've got to think about their motivation,
mm-hmm.
backstory, what then, you know, where they're going. You don't have anything like that in commercial work. So how do you sort of like mentally prepare yourself to actually give that kind of voice?
That's a really good question. I don't think most people even think about that. The really good commercial actors, voice actors or on camera, do have to still play a character. And I've got basically 30 seconds to get across to you that the specials this week at Stater Brothers Market are the best. It's just incredible. The meat, it's 89 cents a pound. And this I have to be excited about. And if I just bark that into the microphone and pretend I'm excited, it's not gonna come across. So I always think about my neighbor, Michelle. Like, because Michelle, you didn't know this, did you? Otherwise, I just sound like I'm barking at this to my husband, John Sandel. I sound like I'm barking at the microphone. Come on out, buy this, it's really good, you gotta have it. And we, the engineer and I, because we do the spots without a director these days, we'll just go, yeah, we need to do another take. And then I think about Michelle, and I get excited, and I tell her what she can get at Stater Brothers this week for this incredible price, because she's a mom, she's got three kids, she's got to feed them, she's on a budget, her husband's a teacher, they're not millionaires, and so that way I can get excited about, you know, I'm really not, honestly, all that excited that you can get six-pack cans of Coors. I don't drink Coors, especially not in the can, and so I need to find a way to act that just like I would Juliet. Almost like I would Juliet. But thank you for asking. That's a good question. Yes?
I was wondering, you mentioned about the difficulties in the sound group. I was just wondering, maybe in a bit more broader sense, what of your biggest challenges were, and what drove you, and how you pushed forward and overcame it, probably just in terms of career in acting?
Actually, I think my biggest challenge in voiceover has happened just this past year. Yeah, I'll tell you a Tenshi story in a minute, but right now I'll just tell you that my newest endeavor is audiobooks. And audiobooks are booming right now in the United States. I don't know if they're the big thing here or not, but the market has gone crazy. And they don't do them in professional sound studios. You don't go to a sound studio where there's an engineer and a director and all that stuff, unless you're one of the top narrators, which, since I'm just starting, I'm not. Not yet, I will be. But Jim Dale, for example, a great British actor who did the Harry Potter books, he's very popular. And when Jim Dale goes to the studio, he has everything he needs, and he doesn't have to do a thing but tell the story. But modern audiobook narrators have home studios now. They work with digital equipment, and they self-direct. So I just finished my first audiobook. It's going to be live, hopefully within a week or so, on audible.com, and it's called Witch You Well, like Wish You Well. It's about witches, so it's Wish You Well. And it's my first one, so be gentle on me. And I hope you'll listen to it and give it a review and be nice. The author has just been great. Her name is Colleen Cross. And she's a Canadian author, so ACX, which is the self-publishing arm of Audible.com, which is owned by Amazon, because, I mean, what isn't? they've just opened up the market to Canadian authors and UK authors, so I think we're going to see more audiobooks pretty soon. So I do that at home in my closet. I record in the closet, and I edit in my little office, and the only thing I send it out for is somebody to listen to it for me to make sure I did it right. Catch mistakes, find words that I said wrong or dropped or whatever, and then I do the final upload, and we'll see what happens. Just did my first one. So that was my biggest challenge, because I've been meaning to do it for 2 years, and I was so scared of the technology, but I like it. I really like it. It's fun. And my most challenging Tenchi episode was one that I wrote about in my book. I have some bookmarks. I've got two books. One is called Act As If, Stumbling Through Hollywood with Headshot in Hand. And in Act As If, I just tell little stories about what it's like to be an actor in Hollywood who's not a big movie star, just a working actor. What's it like? Auditions, casting directors, agents, stuff like that. And one of the chapters is about Ryoko, when the producer, when we were with Pioneer, it was Miyoko Mura, the Japanese producer. And Miyoko really wanted me to sing in this episode. And she said, "Oh, you can sing." And I said, "Oh, no, I can't." And she said, "Yeah, you know, I know you can. You have a good voice for talking. You have a good voice for singing." I said, "Actually, it's not the same. It's not the same training, it's not the same work, and it's certainly not the same confidence." And she gave me the music and said, "Go home, practice, you can sing." So I went home and practiced this thing, and I thought I was great. I worked on that, and I thought I was really great. And I'm sure my neighbors were sick of me, but I got back to the studio, and when I walked into the studio, I was so terrified, because I realized I'd been lying to myself. And so I made them set up the microphone kind of in a corner. So I was like, over here, well, as far as I could get from the engineer. And I wanted him not to be able to see me. I wanted to hide and see if I could maybe do it if nobody could see me. You know, and finally, and Miyoko was at least kind enough not to make me do a second take. And she just thanked me and said, "Okay, maybe you can't sing." She got a real singer to do it. And I don't know what that one is. It's not the karaoke episode, because that is me. Sort of talk singing, which they let me do. But there's another episode where Ryoko sings a kind of a rock tune or something. I don't remember what the song was, because I never had to sing it. Not publicly, anyway. So that was another big challenge. You know, you ask me a question, and I'll just go on for a while, won't I? I see you nodding. No? You don't agree? Want me to talk more? Okay. Just kidding. Any other questions? Yes?
Following on from the audiobooks, are you planning to do your own as an audiobook?
I am planning on it. Yes. The book that I have that's from my heart is called Camelot and Vine. It's a play on the phrase Hollywood and Vine. The reason being that the main character is a Hollywood actress, but she ends up in 6th century Britain in King Arthur's war camp. And I did my research. I know that King Arthur's war camp was not a fancy castle with turrets and flags, and I also know that King Arthur probably never existed as such. I just wish he had. And so this is the story that kind of came from my heart at a time in my life when I really felt unsure of what I was going to do next, I really didn't know. And right at that time, I came to England. And I took a summer acting class at Oxford, 4 weeks, and then I had some time to tour around. I think I was telling you about this earlier. And my friend and I ended up atop the Glastonbury tour with a guide, and we could see this low, flat hill to the southeast, and I asked him what it was, and he said, well, that's Cadbury Castle. That used to be Camelot. That's where Camelot was, or at least that's what they say. And I thought that that was kind of weird, because I knew that Camelot didn't exist, but then I thought, did it really? Is that a real place, Camelot? It's Camelot? And so my brain wheels just started turning in. This story came to my mind about wanting to go there. I wanted to go there. So that's the story I wrote. It's going there. Is that true? Oh, and am I going to do that book?
Yes.
Audio book. Yes. But I'm going to need some coaching, because most of the characters in the book are British. My English accent is sort of general and not really English. And I need some coaching. And also, most of the characters are men. They're soldiers. And you know, we have the King Arthur people, Arthur and Bedwyr, and Dinadan, he's mentioned, but I'll let you find out why. He's not actually in the book. Anything else? Yes?
When you were voicing Ryoko, did you feel any sort of connection to your own, like...
To Ryoko?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yes. She is so out there. She's not like me in some ways. I don't wear my emotions on my sleeve like she does. She can't keep them to herself. She's all over the place. She's mad, she's glad, she's happy, she's silly, she's vicious. She's everything. And I love that about her. It was so fun to get to put all, because we all have that in us, right? It was so delightful to be able to put all that into a character. Because in the theater, or on television, or in a film, you don't get to play a character that you don't look like. That's what typecasting is. If you put me on TV to play Ryoko, well, I don't really look like Ryoko. For one thing, let's just face it. I mean, she has this figure. Her legs are 10 feet long, and she's got that hair. And she's a lot older than I am. She's 2017 years old, something like that. Yeah. So, no, but that's what typecasting is for. It's because the TV audience and the film audience, we know something when we see it. We immediately know what it is, because we're so visually oriented to characters. And it's one of the reasons why animation is so fun for the actor, because you get to play a character that you might not get to play on screen. So I got to play all of that in one character. And she was a great, great job, great fun to play. Yeah. So I did. I connected to every bit of her, every bit. Even the viciousness. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes?
Quickly follow on to my real question. Your favorite Shakespeare play other than Romeo and Juliet?
Well, I'm not sure that's even my favorite play. I just always wanted to play the part. My favorite play. Yeah, that's a tough one too. Well, maybe that is my favorite. I do love that play. I do love it. And I know it very well because it was so influential to me. Also, Macbeth, that's a great piece of theater. King Lear, I mean, once you start, you know, it's hard to stop. I once got to play the Empress Tamora in Titus Andronicus. That was fun.
I just saw the little statue of you perform that.
Oh,
brilliant play.
Must have been great.
Oh, fantastic.
You know the one I got sick of for a while was A Midsummer Night's Dream. Because everybody was doing it. The year that I came here to study at Oxford, We got to go see a play at the Royal Shakespeare in Stratford on Avon, and it was Midsummer Night's Dream, and I thought, oh, I want to see it. Everybody was doing it that year, and it was great. They're great. Anybody who hasn't asked a question yet who wants to ask something? Yes?
Okay.
Yeah.
Is it the last time you would have played Ryoko was Tenshin Tokyo in year 2000?
Oh, I'm not sure. Maybe so.
When the latest series, because Tenshin continued after that, the latest series came out and I think somebody else took the license and did their own dub.
Yes.
And Ryoko's voice changed.
Yes.
Which was difficult for people who were
not
the original voice. Would you have loved to have continued taking the role of Ryoko?
Yes. Yes. The actress who played it is Mona Marshall, and she's a top-notch anime voice actor. And I've never actually met Mona, although we're Facebook friends. But some of the fans were really mad. I don't think it's because she wasn't good. I think it's because she was different, you know. So I was sorry that didn't work out with Funimation. And I don't think Funimation likes me very much, which is too bad. But if they do it again and they want me to do it, I would absolutely love to do it. And there is the new series, the Ai Tenshi Muyo, which has newly drawn characters, from what I understand. They're very, yes?
There's actually a new OVA series coming out.
There's a new
moment.
OVA, okay. Have they done an English dub?
No, it's literally in the process of coming out in Japan. It's sort of coming out every couple of months, and next episode's on August 30.
Well, see, I don't even know. People have asked me if I'm going to do it, but I don't even know if there's been an American producer chosen or hired to do it yet, so I don't know what would happen. We'll see. I hope so, because I think I could still do it. I don't know. Do I sound like her?
Yes.
I'm always afraid that, I was saying earlier, I guess you might have heard that people say, well, can you do Ryoko's voice? And I think, oh, yeah, no, I don't, that's how I talk. That's, I think, how I talk. I sound like her. She sounds like me. Who else? I know you had another one. Let me just make sure that, because how much time do we have? Do we have
Yeah.
Oh,
yep.
We can go on forever. Okay. Yes.
When did you realize that voice acting was something that you really wanted to do? When did you realize it was your passion?
I think maybe very much later than you might think. It's not my only passion. I think we're all allowed to have more than one. I was initially very passionate about stage acting, and I wanted to be a TV star or a movie star or some kind of star. And then I did get to work in some television, not too much film, but some television. And I liked it, but it made me so nervous and uncomfortable, and I was afraid I'd forget my lines, and I never really felt like some of the great actors who can really just kind of loosen up and play the part and maybe even toss a word aside. I was so afraid I was going to lose a word that I could never just focus on playing the part. On stage I did focus, but on TV it wasn't as easy for me because there's cords and stuff around your feet, and if you step over here and you were supposed to be over here, then they're not going to get the shot, and you have to do everything so technically perfectly. There's no improvisation allowed. And I lost my passion for that kind of acting. But voice acting, I don't know if there was any moment when I realized that I loved doing it. It sort of gradually grew on me. When you start to realize that something is really fun and it's exciting and it's a challenge and it's not, it doesn't just make you, scared and nervous all the time, then you can start to have a good time with it. So I can't really give a definitive answer.
Thank you.
but I've been enjoying it for years. What's your question?
Please tell me to be quiet because if you don't, I will hold it. What were your thoughts on Final Tenshi, movie Tenshi Rover? Because that was actually quite a typically different story. It wasn't so much the typical harem story, it was actually more of a buddy-buddy film between Aeta and Miyoko. And Miyoko seemed to demonstrate a maturity that wouldn't necessarily say it was absent, but was not quite as developed in the other two TV series. How did you feel like she was, and also how was the winner in that film?
I think that the stories changed so vastly each time. Each movie was so different. Each OVA was so different. I attacked each one. She was the same character, but at different stages of her development, I guess I would say. So I liked doing them all. I think, and it's been long enough that I don't remember certain things as, was this the movie or was this the OVA? And there's one I know that I really liked doing, which was, I think, an OVA and not a movie, was when Ryoko went bad and she was flying around the universe robbing banks with Kagato. I liked that. That was fun. I liked working with Jennifer Darling as a character. Of course, she played Ayaka. And I never actually worked with her, as I said. We worked separately in the studio, and I would always hope that I could hear her to react from. I didn't always have that pleasure, but when I didn't, then, and I was the one recording first, then she would get to hear me. So I thought that we worked pretty well together, especially in that film. Yeah. And partly because the script was written for us to do that. Also, remember the big bath scenes? Those were fun to play with her, too. Yes?
Did you know that anime was a thing before you got into Tenshi? Like,
no.
You were aware of it?
No idea. I had no idea. I was, I had seen anime, and there, when I was a kid, which was maybe before you were a kid, we had Speed Racer. Which was, nothing happened in Speed Racer. Nobody moved, and there was that dumb song. And I thought, well, if that's anime, yeah. Interesting. So I didn't know it was a thing. And then we did Tenshi Muyo, and it was more colorful and fun and interesting than what I had seen before. And very early on, we started in 1995. And it was probably 95 or 96 when Miyoko took the whole cast to a convention in San Diego. I was so clueless. This was the beginnings of Comic-Con. And I didn't know. You know, we were gonna do a panel. And I thought, what's a panel? I didn't know what a panel was. And a couple of the Japanese actors came. They came all the way from Japan to San Diego to sit on that panel with us, and one of them was Ai Orikasa, who played Ryoko in the original. And we sat next to each other. She's a little, cute thing with a lot of talent. And the room was packed, and they only wanted to talk to her. They just didn't know who I was, they didn't care, I didn't care, that was okay. I just thought she was really something, you know, and she was, and she knew how to handle that room too. You know, she knew how to be, how to use her voice to be everything that they wanted, and she was great. That was exciting. That's when I started to realize, oh, this might be something. But I didn't really know that anime was a thing until maybe about 10 years ago. I mean, I was beginning to know when I started getting invited to cons. That's been about 10 years. Yes.
You mentioned it was quite stressful doing like TV acting and things. But when you're doing the voice acting, do you feel that you lose something by not being completely like immersed in the character? Like sometimes I'll watch a film and I think this looks so fun to do, but the actors just have, like, you know, laughing about it just looks fantastic. Is that the case, or am I misreading that? Or is it
well, I can't speak for other actors, but it's very technical work. It's not as easy as it looks. When I watch somebody, who's a good example, George Clooney is a good example, or Emma Thompson. She's like, she's my higher power. I love Emma Thompson. When you see those actors work on screen, their work is so much different than working on screen because they work very small, because the camera just, you know, they take up so much space on the wall in the movie. You know, somebody's face there, that's huge. If they do something like go, that's just, you don't want to see that, you know. So they have these very big emotions in very small ways, and it's really, not everybody can do it. I don't think everybody is good at it. And some of the best actors are those who do the least on camera. But when George Clooney leans into the shot and you start to feel all the emotion that he's feeling, and you look at him and he's not doing anything, but you're feeling the drama of the moment. And I'm thinking of a moment in The Descendants, which is a film that takes place in Hawaii, and it's his family and his wife is dying, and he discovers when she's in a coma that she has cheated on him. And so this is all of this happening. She's dying, but then he's angry, and all of this in this one little moment, and it's such a close-up, and he doesn't do anything. And you just, and what he understands is that it doesn't matter what the actor feels. It doesn't matter what the actor is doing emotionally to themselves. What matters is what the audience feels. That's the, so he's giving you all that. I really admire that kind of work. And no, it's not. There is nothing missing in the sound booth. It's it depends on what you're doing, what you're playing. But in an audiobook, for example, I get to play all the characters. And I feel everybody's emotions, and I switch back and forth. I didn't know that I could do that, but I can, and it's really fun. But I don't think it's... There is a difference. It's still technical. I have to be right. I have to be positioned right for the microphone. I have to get the words exactly right. And I can't be flailing my arms around because that makes noise. But it's just a different technique. I've seen some great stage actors who cannot do voice acting. It's just not what they can do. It's a different training. Yes.
There any time working on the Tenshin Yuya series, is there any other character that you grew fond of
that I'm fond of?
Yeah, besides obviously the Yoko. Is there any other character that you really?
No, there's none of them. I don't know. Well, I like them all, but Ryoko doesn't like them all, and sometimes it's hard to separate myself from her. I really like Tenshi's grandfather. He's a great character. And Tenshi's father is kind of an old lech. Nobuyuki, yeah. There's one scene where he's looking in the room and he sees Ryoko in there and he thinks, oh, Tenshi got himself a sexy girl. You know? And he's going, hey, at the window, those Japanese are weird. You try to do that in the United States and you get arrested.
Hey, you become a member of Parliament.
I don't even want to know. Oh, give me just a moment. Who else? Did you have a question? Yes.
Yeah, I've actually got two because one's a carry on from what you were
Okay. So the first question, I had my office skills, and I worked in an office. And instead of just working in any office, I found myself a job in a small production company that produced commercials. And they produced mostly low-budget commercials and late-night infomercials and things like that. But I made friends there, and one of the clients was this grocery business. So when they decided to get a new voiceover, they were using a man for a while, and he was an older guy, and he was retiring, and they thought, okay, well, let's get a woman. The producer took my demo to them, and that's how I got that job, and that was the job that I was really able to survive off of, although there have been other jobs interspersed, but that's been the mainstay for a long time. And I also did some radio. I was a DJ for a while, but boy, if I thought that it was technical to be on a TV set, it's really technical to be a DJ because you're all by yourself. And at the time, it wasn't all digital. It was about to become digital. It was kind of right at that cusp. But I also did traffic reports. I don't know if you guys have traffic reports here. Yeah? Okay. Why wouldn't you? That London. So many great highways. With all those exotic names like the M403. Oh, it's so beautiful and romantic. It is. We're looking for that part next week. And what was your second question again?
About how did you feel, and what was your experience doing those really low machines, scenes with Ryoko, where it was like, not so much happy joy,
yeah. You know, I think that's something that actors practice, and it's part of the fun, is finding that emotion in yourself. Like I said, it's more important what the listener feels than what I feel. But if I can tap into something that's real and useful, and I can get it across, if I can't get it across, it doesn't matter. What is the phrase? It doesn't matter if you're in the moment if the audience isn't in there with you. You have to give the audience the moment. But I have fun playing that stuff. I love the one where at the end of the episode we think Ryoko might be dead. She's in that chair, and her arm is hanging, and there's... Oh!
Got me so much that.
Oh, yeah. Got me too. No, it is. There are no more episodes for me. No, I really liked playing all of that stuff, but some of it is felt very real in the moment, but that's part of what acting is. I don't know if you're familiar with the actress Laurie Metcalf. Laurie is an American actress who's, she's done a lot of television and also a lot of stage, and she's just a great Broadway actress, Chicago actress, TV actress, so. And I saw her do this on stage. Years ago, when I was living in Chicago, she was playing Laura, who is the crippled daughter in Tennessee Williams. The Glass Menagerie. And this is a very dramatic part. She's got this insane mother, and she can't. She's also got sclerosis. I think, which is lung disease. And she's this poor little girl with a limp, and she's, you know, living this awful life. And I watched this play, and I was just sitting far enough on the side that I could see the actors before they made their entrances. And I happened to see Laurie waiting for an entrance. She's just about to come on to do a hugely dramatic scene, and she shot a moon at somebody on the other side of the stage, which is this. You know, she flipped up her skirt and her underwear and everything at the other side of the stage. She's having a blast back there, and then she comes on stage and it was completely believable. She could switch those things on and off, and I think the really good actors learn how to do that. And it's still just as real. you had a question.
Oh, and I'd like to know, what's the most rewarding thing about doing audiobooks?
The most what thing?
Rewarding thing about doing audiobooks.
Since I've just done the one, my answer might change at some point, but right now I would say what's really rewarding for me is that I've sort of become my own audio studio. That I do almost everything, and that's really fun. But I get to do the editing, and the directing, and the engineering, and things that I never knew how to do before. So the learning, I guess, of all this new stuff is really exciting for me. And also playing all those parts. Yes.
Should we ever get the guy?
No. You know why? If anybody gets the guy, there's no show. Right? So, no. I don't think she should. Well, does it have to end? Yeah, the party continues. The carnival continues, yes. Yes.
I will say that every series done by the creator of Tenchi has ended up with the guy getting all the girls.
Yeah. That's what a harem series is, right? Although, Tenchi, I haven't seen the others. I know that there is a genre of harem series. And Tenchi is pretty tame, you know. Getting all the girls doesn't mean actually getting them.
Oh no, GXP, he marries all of them.
Oh, he marries them? Ah. I wasn't in that one. That is weird.
It was mostly about the space police force that the house was in.
And Tenchi's cousin?
But Ryoko's part in that is pretty small.
Yeah.
Oh, was? Oh. There was one where I had just very little to do. Yeah.
That was
funny.
Another one where it's another relative business where it goes to an alternate dimension with
Warren getting on.
The one I didn't like was when Tenchi was. I think he was in college or something, and he met this other girl. Other. Yeah.
I didn't like it. I liked it as a separate thing, but as a Tenchi thing.
Do we have time for more? Okay. About a couple more. Any other questions?
What would you say is the most sort of single important skill you've either practiced or developed during your career?
Wow. I would say it's the skill of resilience, bouncing back. Being an artist in any genre is not necessarily lucrative all the time. It comes and goes, and I think even, you know, famous actors, they might have their moment and then they disappear and you forget about them because they're not doing anything that you've seen, and then you go, oh, wait a minute, what happened to so-and-so? Well, they're doing something, probably. And you may not know about it, but I think sometimes we have to reinvent ourselves. And we just, as long as you can continue to do that, and that means whatever skills you have today may not be useful to you tomorrow or 5 years from now. But if you can keep learning the new skills, believe me, since I've been an actor, everything's changed. When I started working, how many years ago? 35 years ago. Oh, we didn't have email. The computers existed, but not in this way where we have them in our pockets and on our desks and basically where we can do absolutely everything with them. You know, So I had to learn how to do that. I don't know what you're going to have to learn how to do, but you have to keep up with it. Whatever is the new thing, as soon as you feel yourself saying, "Oh, I don't want to try that," that's when you know you have to try it. You have to, or else you're going to do what I did for the last 2 years and wish I could do audiobooks, but then be afraid to try. And then finally, I tried it and I loved it. You know, so I think that's it. Well, thank you all for coming. I hope you'll come to my other panels. I didn't bring my schedule, but we're going to talk about writing, and that's tomorrow morning, I think. And that's,
I'm just fine.
Oh, okay. I think all my panels are in this room, aren't they?
Yes.
Okay.
We've got, your every story is this room at
2:30. 2:30, okay. And then there's also another one on Sunday, which is, where we talk a little bit about. Well, that's in the theater.
Okay, that's at 10 o'clock.
And that's when we're going to talk a little bit about careers and ideas for how to get started on things that may not be just a conventional job. Mostly that one is tossing ideas around for each other, as opposed to me telling you how to do it, because I don't really have all those answers.